So AMD's latest chipset, the X570 chipset, has proven itself to be a pretty awesome chipset. But motherboard manufacturers want to give you bigger and better features. That way you can keep buying boards. But AMD hasn't delivered a new chipset. Motherboard manufacturers have taken it upon themselves to bring you the X570S chipset. In this video, we're going to be doing an unboxing and an overview of the AORUS Master X570S motherboard. I'm going to be showing you the features and specifications of this motherboard, and we'll do a little deep dive to see everything that's different between this board and the original AORUS Master. So let's get started. All right, so here she is again, the AORUS Master X570S motherboard. You can see the little eagle right over here, X570S AORUS X570 chipset. And on the side here, X570S AORUS Master. Same thing along here, except some serial number, UPC, and all that good stuff. Along the top, just literally motherboard, DDR4 memory, QFlash Plus, Gigabyte App Center, and a bunch of different languages. Then along the bottom, some features and specifications on the board, but we'll get into all of this in a minute. So I'm just taking out the board. I'm gonna put it aside for right now. Oh, that's why it was fighting me taking it out, because this is its own separate slot. So that's kind of nice. Just setting it aside for right now to get to this, then we'll come back to the board. Okay, so at first I thought it was a mouse pad, but this is actually a bunch of different stickers. Kind of cool, some case badges potentially. Danger, AORUS trespassing, AORUS detected, AORUS, please do not disturb. A little tiny, teeny tiny door hanger, maybe for little mice and everything. But then here they have the AORUS cable labels. Kind of nice, so you can wrap the cables where they go. And then the AORUS passport. That's pretty cool, actually. That comes directly underneath that little motherboard compartment. It is such a heavy board. All right, then multilingual installation guide. And you don't have to worry about this, guys. I am going to be doing a video showing you how to build with this motherboard, so stay tuned for that. Then the AORUS Master Gaming Motherboard X570 AORUS Master User's Manual. But, you know, this will have good information. So definitely something handy, though you can also get it online and it will be updated in case they've made changes. Then a little case badge comes covered, and on the back side, some 3M adhesive. And let's see, anything else? Okay, I was worried that they didn't have a bunch of cables and stuff. Oh, look at that. Okay, so Velcro ties, maybe for cabling. That's kind of nice there to wrap some cables up. Cool that they include two of those. Then they include a noise detector cable, which is actually a pretty good idea. Maybe dangerous too, I'm not entirely sure just yet. So what this does, it will adjust the RPMs and everything inside of your case, making sure that the fans aren't creating too much noise and everything. And then if it gets too noisy, it'll adjust. Mind you, you can make your own adjustments. Might be kind of cool. It's about 6 inches long, the cable. Then they include this wireless antenna. All right, so covered up to keep it looking all nice. Nice and new for you, no scratches. And you can also adjust it, which is really nice. Okay, then rubberized down here. Then along the back here, this is going to connect to the rear ports on your motherboard, and I'll show you that in 1 second for the antenna. All right, and it includes this little adapter here to let you know where all of the cables and front panel little headers go on your motherboard. For those of you that move it a lot, this is actually pretty handy. So they include that. And little instructions on how to use it as well. Then they include in four separate packets. I don't know why they don't put it in just one, but M.2 screws, all four of them come in the motherboard box. I do recommend taking them out of here and placing them inside of a Ziploc bag altogether so you don't lose any one of these. So they include here an RGB LED strip extension cable, just in case. So definitely handy to have. And if you don't use it here, save it in the box. You may need it at some point later on. And this is about 16 inches. I'll put the measurement down in the description below. Then they include four SATA cables. Now they're just not regular SATA cables. One is one straight end to another straight end. But then they have one that is a 90 degree, so straight on one side, and then 90 degrees on the other, which comes in handy if you're connecting a mechanical drive inside of your case to have it here to hide the cable, or the SSD, again, just to hide the cable maybe back underneath the SSD or somewhere out of sight, out of mind. So they include a baggie with the straight and the 90 degree, and then another baggie with the same, so four in total. And then two thermistor cables to connect onto the header on the motherboard, and then they're to the heatsink or wherever you're trying to record thermals. All right, and so that's everything here for what was inside of the baggie. So let's put that away real quick. So even though I stated it before, I want to mention again, this is a tremendously heavy board. I'm actually incredibly impressed on how sturdy it felt taking it out of the box and just putting it down. It felt very sturdy. So first off, let me just take all this off. Again, they put it on like all manufacturers do to keep it from getting scratched while being handled. Definitely. For thermal reasons, of course, you want to take it off. So again, this is based off of the AMD X570 chipset. We can see right along here, they do have two 8-pin EPS CPU powers to provide extra power for your CPU, especially when you're overclocking. You only need to plug in one, but there is two. The second is for overclocking. You notice around here, they have the little shield just to make sure it is nice and solid. I'm incredibly impressed by that. And then coming along down here, we have the 14+2 or 16-phase power delivery. Now, unlike the original AORUS Master, this does not have a dual bias. Not a huge deal. If you're not overclocking, it's not a big deal at all. If you're overclocking, it's just a little inconvenient. We'll see right over here, it does have support for DDR4 for DIMMs, supporting ECC and non-ECC unbuffered, and XMP up to 128 gigs. We can see here with the memory armor. Now, this does have right along here their direct touch 3 heat pipes along with the fins array 3 to keep things nice and cool. With the standard ATX 24 pin, it is not a 90 degree, it is straight up. We can see right over here their post diagnosis display for when it's booting up, you can see what the postcode might be in case there's an error there. This does have 3 PCIe by 16 slots, but this is a by 16 electrically, a by 8 electrically, and a by 4 electrically. So while they can all three fit by 16 cards or by 8, this one will work at 16, 8, and 4. Now, it also supports quad crossfire and two-way crossfire. Unlike the non-S AORUS Master, this one does not support SLI. The X570 non-S did support SLI. Right over here would be the 570 chipset. There is no difference between the 570 chipset and the 570S chipset, other than the fact that there is no fan right over here, which is a good and a bad thing. Obviously, a fan would help cool this, whereas a regular case fan and everything could help cool it as well. But sometimes, or a lot of times, those fans do die. They can get incredibly loud and a few other issues, so pick your battle there. The S because it doesn't have a fan here. It has a larger heatsink to dissipate that heat a little bit more effectively. Now, talking about heat dissipation, this does support 4 M.2 SSDs. So you'll be able to have, let me show you real quick. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. The first one supports SATA and PCIe M.2 by 4. The second one will support PCIe by 4 and by 3 as well. Now, the third and the fourth support SATA and PCIe by 4 by 3 as well. Also requires the AMD Ryzen 5000 or 3000 series processor. We can see right over here, 6 SATA 6 gigabit per second ports supporting RAID 0, 1, and 10. Now, scattered across the board, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 2 amp fan headers. They're 4 pin, but they will also work 3 pin as well. Definitely supports PWM, which is awesome. I love when motherboards have a ton of fan headers. Now, talking about headers, there is 1, 2 4-pin RGB headers, and then there is 1, 2 ARGB headers, which is definitely nice to have. Then over here, you'll find a button. That button has not just one function. It's a multi-key button that can be set in the BIOS to reset for RGB, direct to BIOS, or safe mode switch. So that's a cool little feature as well. I've actually never seen that before. The internal power switch button. 2 USB 2.0 headers. 1 integrated USB-C front panel header. And a Thunderbolt add-in card connector. Then over here, where you connect your front panel headers, also that adapter would go right in here. 1, 2 USB 3.0 headers. Though the S does not have the USB turbo charger that helps charging devices faster that support the quick charge technology. Not a big deal to me, but some of you might find that important. Here we'll find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 USB Gen 2 Type A ports. We'll find 4 USB 2.0 ports, followed by 2 USB 3.2 ports. And then 1 USB 3.2 Gen 2x2 Type-C port. Right up here, we'll find an Intel i225V 2.5 gigabit LAN port supporting up to 2.5 gigabits per second. And right back here, we'll find an ALC 1220-VB audio codec along with an ESS Saber 9118 DAC chip supporting DTS X Ultra HD and 2, 4, 5, and 7.1 channel audio with SPDIF out as well. Along here with the antennas I showed you earlier, we support Intel Wi-Fi 6E AX210 supporting A, B, G, N, AC at 2.4, 5, and 6 GHz frequency band, as well as Bluetooth 5.2. Back here we'll find a Qflash Plus button to flash the motherboard to support a currently potentially non-supported CPU where your system may not start. And then right over here, a clear CMOS button. These are definitely great to have on any board. So the differences between the X570 and the X570S are kind of small, but they might make a difference to you. First off, the original supported SLI. The S does not, but really, you don't really need SLI or Crossfire anymore these days. The impact to performance is very little. Thankfully, the S has more USB ports than the non-S, so that is definitely a plus. The S does have one less Ethernet port, whereas the original had the Intel and a Realtek. This only has the Intel. Now, mind you, a lot of us will not be using a secondary Ethernet port, though some of us might, but that's something you should definitely know. The S does not have the turbocharger USB feature. Not a huge deal, at least for myself. For me, I have my phone charging on its own little cradle, wireless, That way, you know, I don't need to worry about any kind of cable, or while I'm driving, or maybe while I'm sleeping. If you charge it directly connected to your computer, just know, unfortunately, it doesn't have that turbocharging feature. One of the features the non-S had that this does not have is the dual BIOSes. For most of us, who uses that anyway? But for those of us that like overclocking and like pushing the limits that occasionally our system won't boot, dual BIOS is amazing. Why we're using it? Oh, everything doesn't work. Click. Oh, okay. Now we're at a working state. So saves you a little bit of aggravation and some time. Some of them are more of a pain in the butt, like clearing the CMOS, kind of a pain, but both ways you can do it. Because the non-S had its own fan over the chipset, it did have a different M.2 cooling plate. Not a big deal, but something I should mention. While the original non-S did have its own chipset heatsink fan, helping keep the chipset alone nice and cool, the S, since it doesn't have it, it has a larger heatsink, so it's able to dissipate a little bit more heat, especially connected to the M.2 ports. And just make sure have adequate cooling. Adequate cooling inside of your case will allow for air to pass over the heatsink, cooling everything down. Those are the differences I could find quickly between the S and the non-S. Let me know if you know of any other differences down below. I'd love to get your feedback on that. Now, I haven't built with this board just yet. That's coming along very soon. If not already, check down in the description as well. But the board is incredibly durable, very tough, very heavy. It looks like everything's built top notch. I'm incredibly pleased how well built this is. It does also come with a 3-year warranty, so that tells you a lot as well. If it's not that durable, it's probably only going to have a 90-day or a 1-year warranty. So that's pretty awesome. Again, I will be doing a build, so stay tuned for that, utilizing this board. So I am incredibly impressed with all the features on this board and the specs. I can't wait to get started to build on this. A few things already I want to get tested, but I'll keep that for the video as well. So stay tuned for that. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please do leave them down below. I reply to every single one of them. So I hope you enjoyed my overview and unboxing of the AORUS X570S Master motherboard. Stick around, there's going to be a lot more. Iggy with ThisBytesForYou up. See you guys.